Thank you. Hallelujah.
We see your kingdom here, O God.
Hallelujah.
His fullness of joy. In his presence, there are pleasure forevermore.
Amen.
There is healing in his presence. There is joy in his presence. There is love overflowing in his presence.
Hallelujah.
Your presence is heaven to us, O God. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord.
Hallelujah.
Jesus, you're the God of all life.
Token work. This is an impactful word.
Yeah.
Lives are being changed.
Thank you, Lord.
Amen. Glory to God. I bless the name of the Lord today. Father, in the name of Jesus, I just thank you, God. I thank you, Lord, for an opportunity to come before your people, God. I thank you, Lord, that you counted me worthy. Holy Spirit of God, speak through me. Let your word be my word. Father, I pray that your word won't turn void, but it will accomplish that which you have sent for. In Jesus' name, amen. I'm going to try my best to stay with my notes tonight. I got some good notes. But I'm going to do what the Holy Spirit says. Amen. I was, a few weeks back, I was really, really disturbed in my spirit. I was just really almost aggravated about all the stuff on TV about elections and LGBT, whatever those letters are, XYZ, whatever those letters. I was just really disturbed in my spirit about it. And so much so that it was, I was aggravated. And whenever I get like that, I pray and I ask the Lord, why am I so aggravated by all this going on? Why is it bothering me like that? And the Lord simply said, you are the light of the world. It might make sense to you. It didn't make sense to me at first. Yeah. He just simply said, you are the light of the world. And as days went on, scriptures and revelations started coming to me just what he meant about that. And I'm going to share that with you. It's been with me. I've been sharing with our women in Bible study. But it's been with me. The Lord won't let me leave it alone because it's important. We are in the last days. The Lord truly is coming back. He really is soon to come. And the stage has been set for him to come. It's everything going on, but the Bible says that men will become lovers of themselves. They will be wine bibbers. Everything is going on. Anything you can imagine is going on now. The stage has been set. But guess who's up on stage? Guess who time is on stage? The body.
Amen.
We can't act like we don't know. We can't act like that it's not. That we, what's this world coming to? We can't act like that. It's our time.
Amen.
The stage has been set and to usher him in. We can't. We can't get caught up in public opinion. We can't decide which sin is the sin that's going to send somebody to hell. The Bible said the soul that sinneth shall die. See, we decided and we designated which sin is the one that's damned to hell. But the Bible says the soul that sinneth shall die. We don't get to decide which one and who does. It's our job to make disciples. Amen?
Amen?
With all the political agendas and people's rights, as Christians, it is our time to rise up with the good news of the gospel. Isaiah 60:2 says, arise, shine, for the light, your light is coming. The glory of the Lord has risen upon us.
Yes.
Let's read that 16. Isaiah 60:2. Y'all bear with me, but I'm telling you that I got done all day this morning. 60, Isaiah 60:2. Thank you. It says, arise, shine, for the light is come, and the glory of the Lord is risen upon thee. For behold, the darkness shall cover the earth, and gross darkness the peoples. But the Lord shall arise upon thee, and his glory shall be seen upon thee. See, it's a lot going on, but we can't be moved by what our eyes see. The glory of the Lord has risen upon us. And it's up to us to take the gospel to the world. So we can't act like, we can't choose which sin is the worst sin. Because the Bible says the soul that sinneth shall die. Amen?
Amen.
It says, Isaiah 61. And it's going to tell us why the glory has risen upon us. 61 and 1. The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, because the Lord has anointed me to preach the good tidings unto the meek. He has sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim the liberty of the captive, and the opening of the prisons to them who are bound, to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord. That's why the glory has risen upon us. And sometimes we get caught up when we get saved that everything's right in the glory, everything is right for us. And it is. But we got to understand, he didn't save us just for us.
Amen.
He saved us so we'll make disciples unto him. Amen?
Amen.
So we have to get out of our selfishness. Because right now, in all the world, that people are looking for answers. And we have answers. So we can't act like it's not us. Tag, you're it. You're the person. God saved you so you can help save somebody else.
Yeah.
He changed your life so you can help change somebody else. Yeah. Amen?
Yes,
but we get caught up in, because of a certain sin, they don't deserve forgiveness. We've made that decision. We listen to what we hear on TV, and we listen to what is popular in every life. I don't want nothing to do with that. I'm saying, I'm good. God is blessing me, I'm good. Not so. It's not as time out for that. I was thinking about when the tragedy that happened in Orlando. And it's a tragedy.
Yes.
And people have speculated why it happened and all that. But here's the thing. Because that young man didn't know how to deal with his inner feelings, he decided to take matters in his own hand and do what he thought was right. Wow. Probably some Christian in a cubicle next to him didn't share the
gospel.
People are searching for answers, and that inner turmoil in them will cause them to act. The Satan will use the inner turmoil to cause them to be destructive, while we sit back with our same selves. With our same selves and say it's okay. We have the nerve to say we don't know what this world is coming to. Why we don't know? It's gotten so bad to, we are saying, it's almost like we don't believe that it's coming back. It's almost like we don't believe. And I'm saying we, because I got aggravated. And the Lord said, you are the light. You are the light. You know somebody that you can touch right now. But you're sitting in judgment of somebody else when you are right. I call you, I save you. Even we forget about why we were yet sinners. He died for us. What about other people? Somebody prayed for me. That's why I'm standing here. So what we need to do as, and I'm getting away from my notes, but I know what to do. What we need to do is stop being selfish. Stop deciding who shall be saved and what sin is greater than the other, and deciding their well they deserve. If we got what we deserve, I would not be standing here right now. I promise you. So God is calling us out of our comfort zone. He's calling us out of that place, of that safe place, because we go to church and we say the right things and we do the right thing. We ain't kill nobody. We don't sleep around. We don't, you know, we got our list of things that we don't do right. But what has He called us to do? Do you know when we don't do what God has called us to do, it's sin? It's against God. It's against God. When we don't do, when we come into the knowledge of who He is and fail to do what He says to do, it's as sin. We can't do that. But we think because we don't have those seen sins that we're okay. But God has called us to the nations. He has called us to the world. And we gotta come out of our selfishness. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Lord. Matthew 28:19 says, "Go therefore and make disciples of all nations." And I'm gonna say that's it for all people. You know, who decide who deserves to be saved and who doesn't. Y'all heard the story about Ananias and Juan talk to Saul. But the Lord said to him, "He is who I'm going to use. What if you decide the person that you don't want to talk to or don't have time for is the person that God wants to use? And you are the person He wants to use that person." We don't get to decide. We have to be listening. We have to be obedient to the Spirit of the Lord. Amen. We get comfortable and we find ourselves talking the same talk as the world. We find ourselves mixing in and being friendly with the world. We find ourselves taking on that mindset and getting left in what God has called us to do. I was so blessed, young man, by that, because when a sinner comes in the presence of the saint, they ought to be compelled to come to God. The glory of God ought to be so thick that they are compelled, because they are compelled to change. Now, we didn't have to say a word. The glory of God was so thick in this place.
Amen.
And He wanted to be saved. Amen. That's the way it's supposed to be. What was it? That were people, their shadows. People fell at their shadows because of the glory of God. That's the way it's supposed to be. Saved. And it's our time to be that way. So we got to get out of our selfish ways. We got to get on our knees. Hear from heaven. And see what it is we need to be doing. It used to be a song a long time ago, right in front of where you are. All of us ain't gonna go across the water. Some of us got right here in Monroe.
Right.
Somebody got a next door neighbor that ain't saved. Somebody got a next door neighbor that don't even know who God is.
Amen.
And we drive our cars every Sunday to church. Not so. We are about being impactful and changing lives and not being told. We're not do-gooders. God has not called us to be good. We can't do good in our own strength anyway. It's like the grace of God.
Yeah.
Amen?
Yeah.
A lot of times we react to based on what our eyes see. Some of us even say, "Well, I've been hearing the Lord is coming back ever since I was a little girl." And I've said that.
Yeah.
I've heard that. But hear me when I say, He's coming back.
Yes, He is.
And the Bible talks about the martyrs will say, "Where is your God? When is He coming back?" They don't even remember that He parted the Red Sea. They don't remember all the miracles He's already done. And they can't believe. But the Bible says that one day is as 1,000 years in the sight of God. And God is not slow concerning His coming back. He's just being patient to give us time to get ready. So don't even get it twisted that He's not coming. He's coming back. But He's giving us time to do what He's calling us to do. He's giving people time to get saved. So it's time for us to be about our Father's business, okay? Sometimes we go in and we say, "I'm just going to mind my business. People just going to do what they're going to do. I'm good." Newsflash. People are our business. People are our business. And they're not going to do it. We have power in prayer. We have power in ministry. So we can't say they're just going to do what they're going to do. They will. We let y'all know this how prayer got out of school. Because Christians say they're going to do what they're going to do anyway. Christians say that. They're going to do what they're going to do anyway. The devil is alive. God has called us to the nation. He's called us to come out of our comfortable place. Turn with me to 1 Peter 3. But we are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a peculiar people, that we should show forth that praise unto Him who have called us out of darkness into the marvelous light. See, if we're not going to be popular. The Bible says that we're peculiar. You forget about being like.
Forget that.
Forget about that. Don't. It is what we we're talking about souls that weigh in the balance. So we can't be free here. We can't let public opinion turn us away. And the thing that is bothering me most is about all that's going on in the world. The media has put us up as angry people, Christians, as angry people who are arguing and fighting and, you know, doing all kinds of things. We're acting like we don't know what's going on. We can't get pulled into that. God's word is what it is. We are to carry the gospel. It doesn't need defending. We don't have to fight about it. We just have to get it. It's up to the person whether they receive it. So we don't have to make a mockery of the word of God and put up our dues. What's that about? We don't have nothing. The words will stand by itself. All we are doing is to carry it. And it's really sad when the media, when somebody that say they're a Christian, they just put them out there. And here we go. The word is the word by itself. Speak the word. Speak the word only. The word, it doesn't need defending. What does the word say about the situation? Here's what God has called us. We don't need to debate the word. We don't need to debate it one for another. Here's what the word says. We are to humble ourselves. Humble ourselves. That means that sometimes we just have to take a breath. Take a breath. And know what the word of God has said about the situation. And you speak that word. And then your job is done. Because some is called to plant the seed. And then others are called to do the water. I guarantee you, you can say what you want. When you speak the word, that person heard it. Because the spirit of God is in them. It may be laying dormant, but that word penetrated. I'll never forget, my dad used to talk to this guy. who was homosexual. And he used to get fighting mad at my dad. Just get fighting mad at him. And my dad was old school. He just went in. He just went in.
Yeah.
And this man on his deathbed called for my dad and said, every time you talked to me and I got angry, I knew you were telling the truth. Thank you for talking to me. And now I'm receiving Jesus. Before he died, you don't know. Just give the word. A good friend of ours, my husband, a good friend, came to us one time and came out of the closet, so to speak, and he said, I wanted to tell y'all first. And in my pea brain, I'm thinking I'm supposed to feel some kind of way, you know. But I found myself still loving him as a brother. We told him our stand, so we told him what the word of God. My husband ministered to him why this might be happening to him. And he's still our friend today. And we'll believe in God for our salvation.
Amen.
Because we don't get to choose who gets saved and who don't.
Amen.
We don't get to choose which sin is worse than the other. We don't get to choose that. We get to carry the word
Amen.
To the lost.
Amen.
That's our job.
Amen.
Colossians 4. I'm going to take this week off. Colossians 4. Yeah, it says continue in prayer. The second thing we need to do after we humble ourselves, we need to pray. It says continue in prayer, watch in the same with thanksgiving, with all prayer also for us that God would open unto us a door of utterance to speak the mystery of Christ, for which I am also in bound, that I may make it manifest as I ought to speak. And this is the part I want you to get inside. Walk in wisdom towards them that are without, redeeming the time. Let your speech always be with grace, seasoned with salt, that we may know how we ought to answer every man. See, God has given us a way to do this thing. He ain't tell us to compromise at all. He said, walk towards those with wisdom, the wisdom that we have, to those who don't have wisdom. Talk to them and season our words with salt. He ain't tell us to bash nobody. Y'all see bashing and whipping? He said, season with what salt do? It makes stuff taste good, don't it? So we got to work on our conversation when we get out there to whip. We're going to humble ourselves. We're going to stop passing judgment. We're going to pray. We're going to walk towards those with the wisdom that we have. Because the light, we have the light of the word. We got the wisdom. The light has shone on us. And we're going to season our words with salt. And my grandma, it says salt, but my grandma told me you can catch more flies with honey than you can vinegar. So if we want to humble ourselves, get off our high horse and realize that the same God that Jesus died for that person too.
Yeah.
Ask the Lord how to minister to that person and do what God has called us to do. Amen?
Amen.
That's the second thing. We have to seek his face. We have to know how to do it. We can't do it ourselves because we're too busy passing judgment. It's just a natural thing. We have to repent of that. It's just a natural thing to think that, I mean, sin is wrong, don't get me wrong, but we don't pass judgment. It's ours to pass judgment on nobody. Philippians 1 and 27. Let your conversation be as it becometh the gospel of Christ, that whether I come and see you or be absent, I may hear of your affairs, that you stand fast in one spirit, with one mind, striving together for the faith of the gospel. Let your conversation be as becoming to the gospel. Stop talking about people. Pray for them. Minister to them. Let your conversation be that of the gospel. Now, the word will do its own cutting. You know what I'm saying? The word will do what it does. But you have to be perfect. First, we're going to humble ourselves. Then we're going to pray. We're going to seek his face. We're going to use our words. We're going to start our words. And then we're going to go and we're going to let our conversation bring glory to God. We're not going to go out doing the count. That's what's bothering about this whole thing, that Christians feel like they're sending people straight to hell. No! That's not what God told us to do. Jesus dealt with a heart of compassion. He saw what the real problem was, and he dealt with the real problem. People act like there's a reason behind that. We have no idea what it is, but if we season our word with salt, if we go with them with our conversation being that of Jesus Christ, then they're more open to us. We don't have to defend the word. Amen?
Amen.
Psalms 141 and 3. It says, set a watch, O Lord, before my mouth. Keep the door of my lips. Incline not my heart to any evil thing, to practice wicked works with men that work iniquity, and let me not eat of their things. We're not going to join forces with what the world is speaking. We're going to speak the word of God.
Hallelujah.
We're going to speak the word of God. God, not yet told. Don't let me say anything that would cause that person not to want to come to Christ. Oh, we're going to give an account for that. Matthew 12 and 36. But I say unto you that every idle word that a man shall speak, they shall give an account thereof in the day of judgment. For by the word that thou be justified, and by thy words thou shalt be condemned. So we don't want to spit out words. We don't want to spit out. Nobody's interested in our opinion, is what I'm getting at. So don't just sit up and have vain conversation. I don't know what's wrong with so-and-so and all of that. You don't give an account for those words. Because you're putting that out in the atmosphere.
Indeed.
You're sticking those words out. And then the Bible says, y'all read it, you're going to give an account for those words. I had a situation the other day. This is funny. I had a situation the other day. Somebody said something about our church. And it offended me. It was true, but it offended me. And I'm like, oh, wait a minute now. I love my church, and I love my church people. But I could not open my mouth. And I don't know if I was more mad about not saying something back or what they said. And I was mad by that thing. It was true, but I was mad. And so the next day I woke up still thinking about it. And the Holy Spirit said, you did good. And I'm like, you did good. In the light of eternity and those people's soul, what would it have accomplished for you to say something bad? Not one blessed thing. It just been a bad argument. Not really an argument, because it was true.
Well, here's what I'm saying. Don't waste your words arguing about stupid stuff. Where are their souls? That should have been my conversation. One of them don't even go to church. So why am I arguing about something she said about our church? And she don't even go to church. This time I just stop playing those games. My church better than your church. Ain't nobody got time for that. Where are you in light of eternity? That should be our conversation. What can I help you to do to see Jesus? Do you know Jesus? When I was a little girl, he used to embarrass the crap out of me. My dad, everywhere he went, he would talk to me 5 minutes without saying, do you know Jesus? And look where I'm standing. Do you know Jesus? That's what it's for. Don't waste time arguing about people say yakety yak. The stage has been set. The Lord is on his way back. We are the light of the world, the salt of the earth. They won't know unless we take it to them. We got to take it to them seasoned with salt. The word of God, not our opinion, the word of God. We don't have to debate or argue the word of God. Take it to them. Present it to them. And it's up to them to receive it. This time I can do a token work. Having potlucks and all that stuff. It's time to say so. It's time to say so because the stage has been set. Y'all see, everything that is ungodly is rising to the top. But guess what's higher than that? God is higher than that. But they won't know unless we bring it. I totally went all around my notes, but do y'all get what I'm saying? We have to open our minds. We have to season our words. First of all, we're going to humble ourselves. We're going to pray. We're going to seek God because it's somebody right around you. We have to see, it's just that important that we got to be spot on. It's just that important. But we got to do it as unto the Lord. As unto the Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Father, I just thank you, Lord, for our time together. I thank you, Lord God, for what you've done in this place tonight, God. I thank you, Lord God, that we're not just marking time or doing things as a token, God, but we're impacting lives. I thank you, Lord God, for this opportunity to repent of every idle word said. And we say, let the words of our mouth and the meditation of our heart be acceptable in our sight. Father, let our words be seasoned with salt. Let it be your words. Let your words be our words, God. Help us not to stand in judgment. Help us not try to play God at the side. We're seeing this worse than the other, God. You said the soul that sinners shall die. But you called us to be the light of the world, God, and take the word to the world. And we thank you, Lord God, for considering us worthy, God. Be glorified in each and every one of our lives. In Jesus' name, amen.
There's only one thing I'm going to say as she was speaking, I put it on my heart. We have traffic jams in the mornings. We have traffic jams in the evenings going home. But you know what? There's never a traffic jam on Sunday morning. So don't tell me that there's nobody out there that would love Jesus. That's the only time we've been praying for me. What's wrong with that picture, folks? Thank you for that word. We have offering. If you have offering, we appreciate it. If you tithe to the church, please tithe to your church. I don't want your tithe. But we would appreciate your offering. I pray God blesses you throughout this week. I pray that you also meet somebody and tell them about Jesus. Because, folks, the time is drawing near. Y'all have a blessed week. Thank you.